Hello all, welcome to my channel. Today's topic for discussion is Sir Patrick Sense, which is a ballad. Medieval ballads are generally anonymous. So this ballad is also anonymous. We do not know who wrote them. They were probably originally an oral tradition and were eventually written down by various people in various places. Because they sprang from an oral tradition, there is a great deal of variation among them. The language is Middle English and often Scottish dialect. While the modern reader can read them, there are many words that are not immediately easy to understand. They are invariably rhymed since rhyme makes it easier to remember something that is being recited from memory. The subject matter is very diverse: comedy, tragedy, love, etc. They are generally down to earth in their subject matter and sentiments. There are three historical events which may have inspired this anonymous ballad, Sir Patrick Sense, and it generates a great deal of debate among scholars as to which of them is the real source. Scholars have not reached an agreement whether this poem was inspired by events of 1281 or 1290. What they agree upon is the fact that the original manuscript was transmitted from Scotland. The ballad was first printed in 1765 in Bishop Thomas Percy's Relics of Ancient English Poetry, and it was reprinted many times. Summary and analysis of Sir Patrick Sense. The ballad depicts the King of Scotland in residence of Dunfermline, who is wandering aloud where he can find a sailor worthy to voyage his ship. Sir Patrick Sense is suggested by an elderly knight whose name we do not know. When Sir Patrick Sense receives the letter from the king, he is not only surprised, but he is frightened. It is winter and it is not very wise to sail at this time of year. The sailors are aware of the dangers. However, they are willing to do the king's bidding. They are also superstitious and they believe it brings bad luck to set sail in this period of year. Against their instincts, Patrick Sense and his men set sail. Unfortunately, they fall prey to a storm and they all perish. They never return to their port again. In the child version, the poem has 45 lines, which are divided into simple 4-line stanzas. The poem was intended to be sung or recited. Therefore, the rhyme scheme ABCB reflects this attitude and oral nature of the work. The rhyme scheme is simple and only even-numbered lines are rhymed. The poem usually consists of one-syllable words, which deliver a dynamic and forceful reportage of events. The narrator employs a considerable amount of direct speech throughout the poem to enliven the story. Descriptions are clear and uncomplicated. The ballad is characteristic of rapid plot development. We find a lot of repetition and parallelism in the ballad. All the above mentioned features generate a great deal of dramatical and emotional effect. Sir Patrick Sense is a prime example of a narrative poem with a tragic ending. Sir Patrick Sense, a Scottish nobleman, is an excellent, skillful and brave sailor who is loyal to his king and fulfills his duty even though he knows he will perish in the North Sea. The first stanza provides an introduction to the whole poem. The king sits on his throne and is desperate for a skillful sailor who would sail his ship. The king wants to find somebody at the same time he sits. This situation gives an impression that he is a static symbol of power. Other people, his subjects, are given orders to carry them out for him. The glass of red wine also put emphasis on his power, and moreover, it represents an unfortunate and inevitable fate because the chalice of red wine may also function as a symbol of blood, doom and death. Sir Patrick Sense does not have any options but to carry out the king's wish. The second stanza introduces an elder knight who claims that Sir Patrick Sense is the best sailor or that sails upon the sea. The knight is described as elder, which implies an idea that he is a respectful and powerful member of King's court. Additionally, he sits at King's right side and has the right to speak up. In the next stanza, the king writes and sends a letter to Spence. It is emphasized that it is signed V and his hand. Thus, it is a letter of command with a royal signature. Spence has to accept the order. He cannot be disobedient because he is the king's subject. When Spence starts reading the first lines of the letter, he laughs. There can be many reasons for his laughter, and it does not have to be necessarily an indication of joy. He may laugh because someone praises his skills at sea. It is possible he considers the letter as a joke because he knows it would be foolishness to sail in winter. His laughter may also be a bitter sign of irony or even sarcasm. He laughs because he knows how ridiculous it is to sail at winter sea. This idea is confirmed in the next two lines. When he realizes the letter is not a joke but a cruel reality, he starts to weep. The tear blinded his eye. He has to accept his fate, which means he is doomed to die. He is aware of the dangers and fury of the sea in winter. He can clearly see his fatal future and therefore his eyes are not blinded, which is an irony. He knows that he cannot escape death. The fifth stanza is introduced with an exclamation. O Kuha, this has done his date. This ill date done to me. Spence would like to know who wants to harm him. We do not receive an answer, although we may suspect some people from the king's court. Example, the elderly knight or the king himself. Another interpretation would be to understand the exclamation as a sign of despair and hopelessness, as a moment when Spence fully realizes his irrevocable fate. This stanza is finished by two lines in which Spence realizes the dangers of winter sea and ridiculousness and futility of the king's order. After reading the king's letter in solitude on the beach, Sir Patrick Spence promptly orders the sailors to prepare for a voyage. Mak haste, my merry men all. Ironically, the sailors are anything but merry. In the last two lines of the sixth stanza, one sailor of the crew addresses Spence and reminds him of a deadly storm. He addresses him as a master. He also knows that they will all die. However, he does not defy his master. Comparatively, there is the same hierarchy as between the king and Sir Patrick Spence. The sailor obeys the orders of Sir Patrick Spence in the same way Sir Patrick Spence obeys orders of his king. The poem illustrates the stratification of medieval society. In the following stanza, a sailor continues his speech and he expresses his fear of the storm. Later, late yesterday, I saw the new moon. We the old moon in her arm, and I fear, my dear master, that we will come to harm. The new moon in the old moon's arms, the shape in the sky, is considered an ominous sign, a bad omen. The sailor expresses his worry about the situation. The eighth stanza is a tragic climax of the ballad. There is a lot of prompt action condensed in this stanza. The Scottish nobles come aboard the ship to be transported back to Scotland. At the beginning of this stanza, we witness the Scottish noblemen come aboard the ship. At the end, we can see their hats floating in the sea. The narrator emphasized the irony of the situations. The nobles, we were Richard late to wet their cork-heeled schooner. They did not want to wet their shoes when they went aboard. Unfortunately, they were all wet and drowned before long. The interest of the nobles not to wet and spoil their expensive shoes, which are signs of wealth and abundance, are presented as petty in comparison with the actions of Sir Patrick Spence. They are noble due to their origin and wealth. However, Sir Patrick Spence is noble because of his brave deeds. The tragedy, the shipwreck, is described as a play of nature, which has no mercy with anybody. At the end of the storm, nothing remained but the floating hats, which represent the dead bodies of the crew. Moreover, they represent the bodies of the dead passengers whose wealth could not avert their tragic fate. The reader can feel a strong sense of vanity in this part of the ballad. The author attempts to express that there are limits of worldly wealth. The 9th and the 10th stanzas are both introduced by the same VP line, "O Lang Lang, may the lady stand." These lines confirm the tragedy and its irreversibility. The ladies will never see Sir Patrick Spence and their lords alive. There are detailed hints at material wealth and worldliness of the noble ladies, their fans, their gold kerns in their hair. Generally, the ladies are displayed with irony. Their fussy and gentle representation stands in contrast with hardships at sea, which their lords, sailors, and Sir Patrick Spence had to face. Moreover, their husbands do not belong to them. They belong to death and sea. The ladies want to see their husbands. However, they will never see them again. Ironically, the last stanza ends with a picture of Sir Patrick Spence, his good ship and the Scots lying 50 fathom deep at the bottom of the sea. The irony of the nobleman's social stanza is underlined with the position of their bodies. "And there lies guide Sir Patrick Spence, we, the Scots lords, at his feet." In the end, Sir Patrick Spence is at a higher rank in society than the nobles. The worldly wealth of the lords is no more significant, and bravery and skills set Sir Patrick Spence above the lords. Thus, the author sets a moral about the limits of material wealth and worldly establishment. Sir Patrick Spence, together with his scalers, is presented as a hero. He is presented as a humble man who is forced to face his fate by external circumstances. He struggles against several natural elements, and he is also a victim of his king's orders. His bravery and courage lie in his acceptance of his king's biddings. Sir Patrick Spence accepts his fate from the very beginning of the ballad. Moreover, he commands the subordinate sailors to follow the same life story. I dare to assert that his life and deeds and the lives of his sailors are presented as a sacrifice. They sacrificed their lives to their king. There are several levels of loyalty in the ballad, which are presented in the characters of the king, Sir Patrick Spence, his sailors, and other people. Moreover, loyalty is strongly perceived as obedience to someone with a socially higher status. It is presented as a must. People with lower social status obey those with the higher social position in the society. The ballad reflects feudal system and its hierarchy of the medieval times. Sir Patrick Spence, the king's subject, does his king's biddings, and his scalers do the same to Sir Patrick Spence. All of them are loyal servants who do not dare to disobey their master's request. The requests are presented as unreasonable and absurd. Nevertheless, none of the characters questions their legitimacy, and none of them tries to avoid their fate. The captain is a fatalistic character. He knows from the beginning that he is doomed to lay down his life, and it is remarkable that he transfers his fate to his sailors and causes their perishing as well. The suffering is collective. All the characters encounter loss and death. The king loses his best sailor and his hope of bringing the queen back to his lands. So this is only a summary of this poem. Hope you all understood. Try to read more about this poem, more about the poetic devices and the structure that is used in this poem. Thank you.